heyday of these. Welcome back. You come with us as we go on a nostalgic journey back to the days when the scooter was king of the road. The craze for scooters hit Britain in the late 50s and early 60s when there was one of these things for every five cars.
Well, today, of course, they're almost museum pieces. And in fact, that's precisely what all of these are. They're all part of the Southend Lambretta Museum, which was set up to preserve the dying Lambretta breed. The Italian machines were the most popular scooters of all. They were cheap to buy and cheap to run, and they became the status symbol of an entire generation. Do you remember the era of mods and rockers?
People try to put us to town,
talking about my generation,
just because we get around,
talking about my generation.
Things they do look awful,
talking about my generation.
I hope I die before I get old. I dig what we all say. I'm not trying to cause a big sensation. I'm just talking about my generation.
Seems like that almost gave the scooter a bad name, didn't they? It wasn't really typical of scooters, was it?
No, that was fairly isolated, yeah. Actually. It happened in the early and mid-60s.
Can I introduce Mike Karslake here, whose fine collection of Lambrettas this is, the driving force behind the museum, if you like. Tell me, why were they so popular over here?
Well, I think, really, it was a post-war boom. The European countries were getting back into production, and of course in 56, 57 the Suez crisis brought about the sale of these things.
And I suppose there was also a certain amount of affluence around too, so youngsters could afford to buy a form of transport.
Oh yes,
like this.
Yes. I mean you were talking in terms of 100, 150 pounds.
Yeah. What's the earliest one you've got in your collection?
The A model here of 1947, and this is a very rare example and possibly the only one left in the world.
Really, very precious then.
Yes.
So they came out in Italy in 47. When were they introduced to this country?
Around about 1950, 51.
Yes, they took a little bit of time to catch on, didn't they?
It did, but once they caught, they went like wildfire.
So if that's the earliest, what about the rarest?
Well, not so much the rarest, but the most unusual is the F model here. This didn't come into the country as a saleable commodity like the subsequent models, but this was quite an unusual machine. It had the kickstart across, and the colour scheme of the day.
Well, so I thought it looks very upmarket, doesn't it, with the white wall tyres. It tells you a lot almost about the feel and the design of that period, doesn't
well,
it?
Well, in the 50s, yes. I mean, what white wall tyres and the maroon colour was typically the 50s.
Would have been the king of the road, isn't
it? Oh, yes.
Well, if that's an unusual one, what was the most popular you've seen over here?
I think we can safely say that the D model over here was possibly the most popular, and it still is a very popular machine for collectors today. And the reason for its popularity was its price.
Which was about?
£119, 10 shillings, if people know what 10 shillings are. But it didn't have any side panels on. It was known as the undressed model.
Yeah. What about its performance?
Well, you would get over 100 miles to the gallon out of it, and you'd probably do about 55 miles an hour.
Good. Splendid piece of machinery. Mm. Well, apart from being one of the most common sights on the roads in the 50s and 60s, Lambrettas were also, believe it or not, equally at home on the racetrack.
On the Isle of Man, scooter racing took over where the Manx TT left off. It might not have been as spectacular or as fast, but in the mid-50s it certainly built up a big following. Between 300 and 400 riders would take part in the scooter TT, held traditionally the week after the main motorcycle events. There were grueling endurance trials, some of them lasting for up to 24 hours, speed trials, sprints, hill climbs, the lot. Sadly, the Manx marathons came to an end in 1976 after an unbroken run of some 20 years. Today, scooter racing as a sport is still very much alive, although the prestige of winning is perhaps not what it was a couple of decades ago.
And here we've got some smashing medals here that Mike actually won at the Isle of Man races. In fact, you were featured in that film, Mike.
Yes, I saw myself on that film just then, yes.
The medals look splendid. What were they all for?
Those were mostly for the 12 and 24-hour reliability runs around the Isle of Man TT course. They were like a miniature Le Mans, and over the 24 hours you had to be back within your time, within 30 seconds either way.
Which showed a lot of the stamina of the driver and indeed of the bike
machine,
itself.
Yes, yes.
Now, this is one of the racing scooters, isn't it? Tell us
yes,
more about this.
Yes, this one is a sort of more modern machine than you saw on the Isle of Man film there. This is about 68, 69, and in fact this was racing 2 years ago, and established speeds of around 80 miles an hour or more at Snetterton.
Mm. Well, apart from racing, in fact, there's still quite a lot of rallying going on, isn't there?
Yes, we have the annual Southend rally every year.
Which attracts about how many people?
About 1,000 scooters.
Mm. Well, coming back again to the more traditional looking scooter, and in fact, this was one that was made in the production line in Milan, wasn't it, before the factory closed down?
Yes, well, this is quite an early one. This was hooked out of a ditch and brought up to this stage.
It's a very good condition. Well, tell us, why did the factory close down, in fact, when it seemed to have been at its heyday almost?
Well, it was purely political unrest in Italy, and unfortunately, being the family business of Innocenti, decided to close it, and it just came to an end.
Which is a great pity, yes. And in fact, the bike that we can see being made there is a bit like the one that Graham and I almost came in on in the beginning.
That's right, yes.
Right.
Yes.
But now we're coming sort of slap bang up to date, because it wasn't the end of the story, was it, when Innocenti closed down?
Innocenti closed 70-71, and then the Indians, 2 years ago, took over production, and this lovely machine here, the GP200, is the current model you can buy today.
Is this actually a very recent design?
No, this design was designed back in 1969 by Bertone, the car designer, and the Indians have taken it exactly as it was produced in those days, but have added refinements like 12-volt lighting and a better exhaust system and things like that.
And what about its power? Is there any difference in that?
In its power?
Well, I mean, is the engine still the same size?
Basically the same, yes. At 200cc, and it's capable of about 70 miles an hour.
And how much would it cost us nowadays?
Around about £450.
Which is quite a lot. How does that compare with other mopeds, for example, of a similar sort of size?
Well, it's more than a moped, but of course it's cheaper than a lot of motorcycles.
And it's very attractive too, and looking very attractive actually is Graham on a very unusual looking contraption.
Yes, what do you think of this then for a runaround? The Lambretta pickup truck. No Italian grocer would have been without one. This particular model dates back to 1955, when it could be bought for the princely sum of £375. Its 148cc engine could pull a load of up to 600 weights, which made it an ideal delivery truck for corner shop tradesmen. Very few, in fact, came into this country, whereas in Italy they could be seen in their thousands. But even this isn't the biggest eye-catcher in Mike Karslake's museum.
And if this isn't the most unusual-looking fire engine you've ever seen, well, I don't know what is. I mean, it really is very unusual, isn't it, Mike?
Well, yes, it is.
And yeah. It is actually a Lambretta.
Yes, it's exactly the same as a scooter, but having three wheels instead of two. It has the same gear change, the same handlebar layout as a scooter here, as you see.
And the same sort of engine capacity,
yes,
it wasn't any
but
bigger.
Yes, the addition of a reverse gear and a cab.
Really? Now, how fast would it have gone?
About 50 miles an hour.
And who would have used it?
Fire brigades in factories, airfields, and these little villages with narrow streets.
It didn't actually go abroad. I mean, we wouldn't have seen any in this country. It would have been really for the small Italian
streets.
Yes,
I think possibly northern Italy, that sort of area. Yeah.
Well, now, Graham was talking about the sort of three-wheeler that he had. I should think that this sort of style was very good for all sorts of trades, wasn't it?
Well, of course, the Lambretta company produces as a cab and chassis, and there were all these purpose-made bodies, pickup trucks, vans, refuse trucks, milk floats, that sort of thing.
Now, we've seen quite a lot of various designs of Lambrettas here today. How many were there in total and how many have you collected?
Well, there's about 50 different types, as far as I can ascertain. I've got about 40 in my collection.
Have you seen all of them? I mean, you think you might be able to
get all
of them?
Yes, I think I've seen all of them, but whether I'll get all of them is another story.
Right. Well, I don't know how efficient this would have been at big fires. I just think it's fairly small fires that it dealt with, wasn't it?
I think the sort of the joke is that it's fine for heavy smokers, you know.
Really? Well, I think we'll go and find ourselves a heavy smoker and very quietly mosey on down the road.
Right.
Well, they always say empty vessels make most noise. It doesn't even carry a pint of water. And from that to...